to the book of Titus this morning, and let's find chapter number 1 together. I thank God for the blood of Jesus Christ this morning. Amen. The world would think it strange for a bunch of people to get together and just sing about blood. But we know that it is where our hope is found this morning. Amen. No other name given among men whereby you must be saved other than the name of Jesus Christ. And it is a precious, precious name. Amen. And it was precious blood that was spilled there at Calvary's hill. Many lambs had shed their blood, but it was not good enough. But one perfect lamb, Hebrews 10 said, laid his life down for us at the cross, and it was good enough for all of time. And it washes all of my sins away. Amen. All the ones in the past, all the ones in the present. And you know something that's amazing about it? There are sins I've not yet committed. That'll be under the blood too. Amen? All my sins are washed away. And I want to preach this morning. I tell you, I don't know about you, but we are... And I don't just want to be one of those people who says, boy, it's worse now than I've ever seen it in my lifetime. You know, but I want to tell you something. We're in some ungodly days. We're in some uncharted waters. We're in a country today that is, we're seeing things that we never thought we'd see before. I said this morning in our Sunday school class. I said, I used to say nothing surprises me, but I want to be honest with you. There's some things that have happened in the last few months that surprised me. I want to be honest with you. It's ungodly days. And we as Christians have two choices. We can either retreat into our churches, gather up with like-minded folks, and talk about how bad it is out there, or we can take up the mantle, get out into the world, shine the light as brightly as we possibly can, and try to bring as many people to Jesus as we possibly can do in the time that we have left. I don't want to be one of those people who just forecasts. I don't want to be one of those people who just talks about how hot it is, how bad it is. I want to change the temperature. I want to be somebody who makes a difference in the world in which I live. And there's only one way that we can do that. It's not with our words. It's not with our talk. It is with our living. We have got to live more godly in this day than we ever have in our lives. The only thing that combat the darkness is the light. And so really the Lord has just been burning this in my heart. Godly living in ungodly days. Godly living in ungodly days. You know, the Bible says in Daniel chapter 1, that in verse number 8, that Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with a portion of the king's meat. Now here's what that means. Daniel purposed in his heart that though everybody in Babylon was doing one thing, Daniel would do another thing because he wanted to be on God's side even if he stood alone by himself. You're not going to accidentally live for Jesus. You're not going to accidentally live a godly life. If you're going to be godly, it's going to be because you're intentional and you've decided, I'm going to follow Jesus if nobody else goes with me because I want to stand with Him. As bad as it may seem, this is not the first time when the ungodly crowd has outnumbered the godly crowd. In fact, I would tell you that it's always been that way. Seems worse. Let me tell you somebody who had it pretty bad. An old preacher boy by the name of Titus. Titus was one of Paul's young converts. Paul was taking him into the faith, and from the time he was converted, Paul was bringing him along, training him, teaching him, discipling him, trying to pour into him the truths of the Word of God. The book of Titus is what we call a pastoral epistle, along with 1st and 2nd Timothy. It is Paul's instructions to young men on how to conduct life in the church. As Paul is writing this letter, he's writing to Titus, who at this point is a pastor in his own church. Titus finds himself on the island of Crete, which is a mountainous and heavily populated area that is absolutely stocked full of ungodly people who don't care anything about living their lives for Jesus. Morally bankrupt people. Unsaved. Not only are they unsaved, but they don't care that they're unsaved. Sound familiar? We were reading in Proverbs this morning. He said, not only do they do evil, but they delight in doing evil. The mark of a Christian, you may do evil. It's in us all. But if there's not some brokenness about your conduct, I'm just telling you this morning, I'm not one of those people who wants to make people doubt their salvation, but I'm going to tell you something. If you can do evil and you don't feel any shame, you don't feel any guilt, you don't feel any conviction, in fact, sometimes you might even rejoice in it, I just want to tell you this morning, under the authority of the Word of God, that's not the mark of a biblical Christian. Sin ought to break us. We talk about how much God must have loved us to send His Son to the cross. But I want to tell you something. When you look at the cross, you ought to see how serious God is about sin. You ought to see how serious God is about sin. So in Titus, Paul is instructing him about how to win the lost people of Crete with the gospel. Step number one. If you're going to win anybody to the Lord Jesus Christ, you got to first know what happened to you. If you want anybody else to be saved and you have any part in it evangelistically, you must first know, number one, what it is that happened to you. I preached a sermon about a year ago, last January, about having a testimony. What's your story? The blind man was healed in John chapter 9. They asked him to explain to them what had happened. He said, I don't know what happened to me. He said, I just know I was blind and now I see. And you may be here this morning and you may be a young Christian in the faith and you may not be able to walk us down the Roman road and you may not be able to tell us all the theological definitions, though I hope to help you here in a minute with that. And you may not be able to explain everything that happened to you, but this one thing you know and you want to tell the world, I used to be spiritually blind, but now I can see. I used to be spiritually dead, but now I am alive in the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm going to tell you something. If you want to just make a difference in the people around you, that's about all you got to know. Just give evidence of the change that Christ has made in you. Walk around like you hadn't been sucking on a lemon for 3 hours that day and just have a smile on your face and be willing and ready to tell people about the difference that Christ has made in your life. I'm going to tell you something. When you live for the Lord, when you just submit to the process of sanctification, you won't even have to tell people that there's a difference. You won't have to walk up to people and say, hey, can you see a difference in me? They'll come up to you and they'll say, man, I see a difference in you. I was talking to somebody just the other day. He said, the people I work with, they just say, man, there's something different about you. There's something that's not the same. I've talked to people in my life who used to cuss at me when we talked, and now they're saying, hope you have a good day. God bless you. And I'm thinking, whoa. Now that's the power of Christ. That's not self-help or self-improvement. That's something only that Jesus can do. So we need to know what it is that has happened to us. And that is exactly what Paul tells Titus here. I want us to read these first four verses together. Paul, a bondservant of God, an apostle of Jesus Christ, according to the faith of God's elect, and the acknowledgement of the truth which accords with godliness, in hope of eternal life, which God, who cannot lie, promised before time began, but has in due time manifested His word through preaching, which was committed to me according to the commandment of God our Savior. Who's he writing to? Verse 4. To Titus, a true son in our common faith, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ our Savior. Father, help us to preach this morning with Holy Spirit anointing. God, give me unction from on high, set my words on fire, do through me in this time what I cannot do unless you give me the power and the spirit that I need. I ask it in Jesus' name, and everybody in agreement said, amen. I want to, just for a few moments, give you kind of a doctrinal sermon. And I want to really leave with you three words and three statements that I think will help us to understand this passage of Scripture that is found in Titus chapter number 1. Number one, let me just encourage you this morning. I would write this down. So many times I've listened to a sermon and I've heard preachers say things and I say, I wish I would have wrote that down. Well, now, I don't say this braggadociously. I say this because I'm just telling you that what I'm about to say is something that you need. You might want to write this down. Number one, I want to give you a word, and it is the word justification. Everybody say that word with me. I'm going to throw it on the screen so that you can see it real good. It is the word, say it, justification. I want to give you a statement. I have been saved. I have been saved. Paul says, number one, in the very first verse, I'm a bondservant and an apostle for the purpose of the faith of God's elect. Paul is giving evidence that he is walking with the Lord Jesus Christ. And there's something that you need to know right off the bat. This is it. Number one, God's desire is to save. Jesus said in John, he said, the Son of Man did not come to condemn the world. The devil comes to bring condemnation, right? He wants to tell you how bad you are, how you'll never get it right, how no matter how hard you try, things will always be the same. You know, you can't get right because your great-great-great-granddaddy on your mama's side did something way back then, and you're just flat cursed, and you're going to be cursed for 14 generations, and there ain't nothing you can get out of it. And that's what the devil wants you to know. He wants to tell you that because you had a two-car garage when you were a kid, but your parents only parked one car in it, that you'll never be able to get right. But I want to tell you something, dear friend, this morning. That's a lie straight out of the pits of hell. Christ came not to condemn, not to bring condemnation. If you stand before the Lord and you're condemned, it's nobody's fault but your own. But Jesus has come to save. In fact, in Ephesians 1:4, Paul points out that before the foundations of the world were formed, God was already making provisions to bring you to himself in salvation. Revelation calls Jesus the Lamb which was slain before the foundations of the world were formed. God has always known that there would be a problem, and the problem is sin, which causes separation between God. But here's a great thing, and here's a great spiritual truth for your life. Before the problem ever arose, God already had the solution. I saw something the other day on Facebook, and it said this: before Zacchaeus ever tried to see Jesus, God had already planted the tree. Now, I don't know about you, but that's pretty good right there. Amen. That's one of those things I wish I would have come up with. So God is not a reactionary God. He doesn't see your problem and then respond. No, God has already provided before the problem ever arises. Paul is here talking about the faith of God's elect. It is that moment in time when I begin to walk with the Lord. I place my faith and trust in Christ, and I begin to walk with him. Now, we often call this justification. Justification. One clever preacher said it's just as if I'd never sinned. What is justification? It's a legal term. To be justified. It is a picture of a courtroom. The Father, God the Father, is the judge. You are the defendant. Your crimes are too many to name. But you may be sitting here this morning, you may say, preacher, I'm not really that bad of a person. Let me ask you this question. How many sins does it take to make you a sinner? Not 100? Not 1,000? Not 5? No, it just takes one. So you are brought to court not really on the basis of your sins, but by the nature of yourself, that you are a sinner. Now, this is one of the real problems that we're having as Christians in the 21st century today. People don't really want to hear who they are according to God. And I'm going to tell you something. It used to be on Oprah, and it used to be on Dr. Phil, and it used to be on Montel where you got the self-help stuff, but now it's infected our pulpits. Come on, son. Preacher, don't tell me how sinful I am now. Just tell me how I can improve myself. All right, let me tell you how you can improve yourself. You can't. Well, preacher, tell me how I can just make some additions in my life. See, so many people in the world today, they view church as like a cherry on top. Well, I'm in this civic organization, I'm in that civic organization. And you know, it'd really be nice to put on my resume if I said I was in church and I worked in these different things. And it won't really be a priority in my life, but it'd be just something that I do when I get time. Listen to what Paul called himself in verse number 1. A bondservant. You know what that means? A slave. When you come into a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, you surrender everything you are about yourself to Him. It's all His. Well, preacher, I want to keep this part back. It's all His. Well, there's this area of my life that I don't know if I can let go of. You better learn to let go of it in the name of Jesus, or you'll never understand true peace in walking with the Lord Jesus Christ. So you've been brought into a courtroom. The charges are that you're a sinner and you have a sin nature. And guess what? You've got a defense attorney. And his name is Jesus Christ. And he pleads your case. He doesn't look at the judge and say, you know, I know he's been bad, but he's done a lot of good too. I know he's committed some sins, but man, you ought to see this guy when he sees an old lady crossing the street. He's the first one there to grab her grocery bags and make sure she gets to where she needs to go. Jesus doesn't say, I know that he's a good person. I know he's committed some sins, but man, you ought to see the wall where his Sunday school pens are laid. He's got one for 3 months and 6 months and 1 year and 3 years and 5 years and all of his life. He never missed Sunday school. Jesus doesn't look at the Father as he sits behind the desk and say, you wouldn't believe how faithful this man has been to tithe. And not only did he tithe, but when the church needed a little extra, he was the first one to grab one of those little envelopes and plug something in there for the building fund. You can't believe how good this guy is. I know he's done some sinning, but he's pretty good too. Jesus looks at the Father behind the desk and he pleads your case, and he does it on one condition. He says, Father, in the name of Jesus, because of the blood which was shed at Calvary that is able to cover all of our sins, I want you to write on this man's record, paid in full. And guess what he does? He does that very thing. He does that very thing. But let me tell you something. Christ doesn't pay your debt for free. People say, oh, salvation is free. Well, it is initially. But Christ wants your life. He wants everything about you. I read a church sign recently. It said, God's not interested in weekend visits. He wants full custody. Well, if that's how you got to think about it, if it works, it works. Justification. We're justified. Paul tells Titus, he says, salvation begins at a moment in time. It's Paul on Damascus Road when a light shines down from heaven and says, Paul, Paul, why do you persecute me? Why are you kicking against the ox goads? Paul is saved. It's the Philippian jailer in Acts chapter number 16. When Paul and Silas are singing at midnight, praises unto God, and the chains break and the doors fly open, and he says, kill me. And they say, kill you? We got something better for you. Why don't you get saved? And he says, what must I do to receive eternal life? And they say, believe on the Lord Jesus, and he'll forgive you of your sins. And guess what he finds? He finds salvation. Not only is that, it's the Ethiopian eunuch in Acts chapter 8 who is gloriously saved by the wayside reading the book of Isaiah. Isn't it amazing? You can read the Old Testament and still find Jesus. He's on every single page and he gets gloriously saved. There's a moment in time for all of us where we say, I have decided to follow Jesus. Now, some people are in this room today. They can tell you the hour, the minute, the time where they were saved. Can I be honest with you and confess something? I knew I was saved. I didn't know when I was saved. I didn't know the date until one day I was flipping through one of David's Bibles and it said, Blake Dodd, saved July 14th, 1999. And I thought, well, bless God, I've always wondered what day it was. And I didn't know, but now I do. Can I tell you something this morning? There's people who have a date who will go to hell. And there's people who don't have a date who will go to heaven. It's not about whether you can tell me when it happened, exactly on the calendar, but there must be a time in your life where a transformation took place and old things passed away and all things became new. It's a doctrine that we hold to, the doctrine of salvation. It's not only knowing the faith, it's acknowledging the faith. Look at what he says in verse number 1. It's the faith of God's elect, our doctrine, our beliefs. When you see that word faith, you often hear old timers say, they'll say, well, he came to the faith, or he believes in the faith. And what they're saying is he's accepted our doctrine. I've heard people all my life say, oh, I don't need doctrine. Dear friend, if you're one of those people, can I just tell you in Jesus' name, don't ever say that again. Amen? Can we just straighten that out here this morning? Let me tell you what you need. Doctrine, doctrine, and doctrine, and more doctrine. All we have is doctrine. Doctrine produces works, but if you don't know what you believe, then you don't know what you're supposed to do. Right? Imagine getting a job and somebody says, go out there and do this. Well, you hadn't told me how to do it. Well, just figure out. No, Christ has not done that to you. He's given you a set of beliefs by which you are to arrange your life under Him. Knowing Christ is not enough. You must acknowledge the truth. I wrote this down. You may know the doctrine of Christ, but do you know the Christ of our doctrine? If you were to go to hell today and take a poll in hell and ask all the demons if they believe that Jesus is the Christ, Son of the living God, you know what they'd say? Yes, it'd be 100 to nothing. 100%. Everybody would agree Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God, but they will spend eternity in hell. It's not just believing that Jesus is the Christ, but it is believing that He is your Lord, your Savior, and your Master. So, justification. I have been saved. Let me give you a second word this morning, and it is the word sanctification. Everybody say that word with me this morning. Sanctification. Not only have I been saved, but I want you to listen to me. I am being saved. Not only have I been saved, but I am being saved. Now, somebody might come up to me sometime, and they might say, do you believe in once saved, always saved? And I like to really shock people. Y'all probably know that about me. I like to say things that'll get people's eyes to bulge open real big like a bug, you know. And they'll say, preacher, do you believe in once saved, always saved? And I say, no. No. Absolutely not. If there's one phrase that's caused more harm in the church today, it is the phrase, once saved, always saved. Well, what do you believe, preacher? Do you believe in eternal security? Now, when people ask me that, I don't try to be cute and funny. I say, yes, I absolutely believe in eternal security. Let me tell you something. The evidence of what happened is what's happening.
Come on.
Now, you say that again, preacher. Let me say it a different way. The evidence of what happened back then, the evidence that it's real, is by what's happening now. How many people have come, knelt in an altar, received the Lord Jesus, been saved, that's what they say, and their life never gives any evidence of the change that they claim?
Come on.
If somebody said to you, that's an apple tree, you know what you'd say? Where are the apples? And when they said, well, that tree doesn't produce any apples, you know what Jesus said about that tree? He said, you ought to cut it down and you ought to throw it in the fire. Jesus didn't pick that phrase, throw it in the fire, for any casual reason. That was not a coincidence. See, salvation is so much more than just a moment in time where you are saved. Look at what he says in verse number 1 at the very end. He says, it is the faith of God's elect and the acknowledgement of that truth which we said is salvation, that beginning moment, justification, which we call it. But look at what he says right there. Don't miss that. You ought to highlight that and underline it in your Bible where he says this, which accords with godliness. How does salvation evidence itself? One word. Godliness. Don't tell me you're saved. Live a life that says you're saved. Don't tell me about the change that Jesus has made. Let Jesus ooze out of every pore that you have so that people will say about you, Jesus has made a change. Godliness. Term for godliness, Eusebia in the Greek, denotes an everyday way of living. An everyday way of living. Hold on now, preacher. Did I hear you say every Sunday way of living? No, I didn't say that. Preacher, did you say every Wednesday night way of living? No, I didn't say that. I said godliness denotes an everyday way of living that displays devotion to God. So let me give you an example. If you're one way at church and you're another way at work, then people at work are going to call into question what you say Christ has done for you. If you're one way in the church house and another way in your own house, and let me tell you something, this is what causes a lot of kids a lot of confusion when they get older. Because daddy goes down to the church house and acts one way, but when daddy gets home, he acts another way, and the kids can't put two and two together. They say, daddy proclaimed to know Jesus, but when we were at home, we didn't see the evidence of it. The man of God needs to be the man of God all the time. He said it accords with godliness, which is an everyday way of living that displays devotion to God. The gospel is so powerful that it is, listen to this, continually changing our lives. Continually changing our lives. Can I say something to you this morning? I am still daily affected by an event that happened to me over 20 years ago. Daily. Still in my life, 1999, that's nearly 20 years ago in July, I'm still affected every morning I wake up by a decision that I made 20 years ago. What is that called, preacher? I would say to you this morning that that is what the Bible describes as sanctification. Not only has Christ saved me in the past, but He is saving me in the present. What is He saving me from, preacher? He's saving me from myself. I used to say, my biggest enemy is me. Now, I'm going to tell you something. I've got to change it because I listened to Brother Ron Lynch preach a sermon the other night, and he said, your biggest problem is not Satan. Your biggest problem is not yourself. Your biggest problem is God. Let me tell you what he said. He said, we don't have any problem telling God no.
Come on.
And we also don't have any problem telling the devil yes and telling our flesh yes. He said, my biggest problem as a believer is that I am bold enough and brash enough for God to command me to do something and me to look at Him and say no. I tell you what I was really thinking in Sunday school this morning as we were learning about wisdom. I was really thinking about when I was a kid. And I'll tell you something, man. Can I just testify to y'all this morning? I was terrified of my mama. Can I testify a step further? I'm still terrified of my mama. She's got a look, and she gets it from my pawpaw, and she furls her tongue up, kind of like in a way like that. And man, when she does it, I mean, it's serious business. Can I tell y'all something? Because she's not in here this morning. She's downstairs. I'm a little bit afraid of my wife. Can any other men in here testify this morning? Amen. You just say, you know, boy, preacher, there's a days when she scares the life out of me. Yeah. Terrifying. She told me this morning, she said, you are not wearing that. Do you know what I did? Went there and took it off, put something else on. And she said, you better let me see it before you go. David Platt said something in his book, Radical. Stuck with me forever. I remember the place I read it. I was in Florida reading on the beach. He said, everything in creation yields and obeys the voice of the Savior. He said, if He tells the trees to blow, they blow. If He tells the waves to crash, they crash. When He told the ocean to stop, it stopped. When He told the mountains to be moved, and they were moved, formed exactly how He wanted them. He said, everything in creation obeys the Creator except for guess who? You and me. He said, we're the only ones in creation who are bold enough, brash enough, and brave enough to look our Creator in the face and say a one, two-letter word, and that is no. Can I just tell you this morning, one of my biggest problems in my life is me. My stubbornness, my flesh, the sin nature that I have within me. I tell you another problem. You say, preacher, what is God saving us from now? I tell you one thing He's doing is saving us from that old rascally devil. I was reminded of something as I was reading this week, and I'm taking a New Testament class at school, and we had to read through the Gospels of Matthew and Mark. Could you imagine being Peter on this day? When he and Jesus are walking along, and Jesus looks Peter in the face, and he says this to him. He says, Peter, Peter. In fact, actually, he calls him Simon. And when Jesus calls Peter Simon instead of Peter, generally it's because he's disapproving something that Peter has done. He's calling him by his old name rather than his new name. He looks at him and he says, Simon, Simon, how often the devil desires to sift you like wheat. Now those of you who have ever made biscuits, you know what that is. Sift you like wheat. Jesus looks at me and says, but Simon, I have prayed for you. The Bible teaches me that Jesus Christ is sitting at this very moment at the right hand of God the Father, making intercession for you and for me. He's pleading my case, my behalf, on my behalf, because I'm not able, because a holy God cannot look on a sinful man. And so Jesus Christ, the God-man, sits at the right hand of God the Father, and literally He prays for me. He prays that I'd have staying power. He prays that I'd keep on keeping on. He prays that I would stand in the faith when it's hard to stand in the faith. When I want to quit and give up, that I would stand. When the devil tempts, He's providing a way of escape. He says, Simon, Simon, how often the devil would like to destroy you, just like he tried to do old Job, but he said, I've prayed for you. I've interceded for you. Can I tell you something this morning? The Bible teaches me that in the process of sanctification, Jesus Christ is daily saving me. It's two words that Paul gives there to help us to understand that. Number one, Paul calls himself a bondservant. It's the Greek word doulos, and it means he's a slave of God. Jesus Christ is the master. Whatever He bids me do, I do. Wherever He bids me go, I go, because I'm His bondservant. There's a second word He uses. It's the Greek word apostolos, and it means apostle. And what that meant back in those days was an apostle was one who was sent. So not only is Jesus my master, but He's also my sender, which means that God has a will for my life. Now let me tell you something about God's will. Number one, God has a general will. Generally dealing with morality. God wants us all to do the right thing, and God wants us all not to do the wrong thing. I had people in my life, and I had adults say this to me when I was a kid growing up. I remember one time one lady said it to me on the playground over at Westside. I don't know, I probably kicked a kid in the shin and, you know, something evil like that. You know, we're all kids, we do dumb stuff. And she called me over there and she said, aren't you a preacher? She said, you're supposed to live better than that. And I tell you, people still say this to me. Old preachers, you know, y'all are just called to live to a different standard. Let me tell you something, Hoss. If it's wrong for me, guess what? It's wrong for you.
Come on. Come on.
If I can't do it, you can't do it. So whatever you're putting up because the preacher's coming over, you all just get rid of it, amen? Because if it ain't good for me, guess what? It ain't good for you. God has a general will. Don't do this, don't do that. I remember Jennifer saying one time, she said, there's some things you don't have to pray about. Amen. There's some things you don't have to pray about. You know it's God's will. So God has a general will. But then also God has a specific will for your life. God wants something for your life. You're His apostle, the sent one. He is your sender. And if you're not doing what God has called you to do, you are resisting the work of sanctification, and you are living outside of God's desires for your life. What is sanctification? Let me give you one statement. I'm going to move on and be done. Sanctification is this. I started, and day by day, God is working in me. And He's changing me from what I was when I started to what He ultimately wants me to be. and it's a day-by-day process. Have I always kept going upward? No. Been times in my life where I've backslid a little bit. Been times in my life where I went away from the will of God. But if you just step back, now don't get too close in on my life now. Don't look at weeks at a time. Just look at the whole picture. And I can tell you today that from 1999 to 2019, I'm not what I was when I started. Paul said one of the problems in the church is that many of you have been saved, but you haven't grown any. He said, you know as much about God as you did when you started. What is God ultimately trying to make us? When we stand before Him, He wants us to be a mirror. He wants to be able to look into us and see His own self, His own reflection. He's conforming me to the image of Jesus Christ. And that leads me to my third point, and I'll be done. Glorification. Not only have I been saved, not only am I being saved, but one day I will be saved. Paul says in verse number 2, we're according with godliness in the hope of eternal life. What keeps us going? What helps us to keep on keeping on? We're striving to reach a destination that the world knows nothing about. What keeps me going on the days when I would rather quit? What causes me to live differently from the rest of the world, even when they don't understand why I live how I live? Because you know that you're not striving for something in this life, but you know that you're striving for something in a life to come. We have hope. Hope is a powerful word in the Word of God. I've always said this when I use this word. The idea of hope in the Bible is different from what we use in the English language. When in the English language I say I hope, well, I hope I eat something good for lunch. Well, it could be something bad. We don't know. We're hoping for the best case scenario. When the Bible uses the word hope, it's a rock solid assurance you can take it to the bank. It will come to pass. Because God, who cannot lie, promised it before time began. The Greeks would sit around and they would contemplate whether the gods could lie. Could they tell us something and it not be true? Paul said, my God cannot lie. And He has promised me the hope of eternal life to stand in glory. And I didn't get to say all I wanted to say about that, but here's what I'll promise you. If you come back tonight, I'll elaborate on it. That God has prepared for us a place. Jesus said as much in John 14. I go to prepare a place for you. So here's my Christian life, if you were to look at it. One day, I began to walk with the Lord. He saved me. Every day, I'm still walking with the Lord, and He is saving me. Saving from sin, from self, from Satan, from this world. But one day, I'm going to walk out of this life and into the very presence of Jesus, and I will be ultimately saved. Can I give it to you this way? Throw up that last slide that I sent you, and I want to say it to you this way, and I'll be done. As they come with a verse of an invitation, y'all can come, go ahead and get ready. Justification. I'm saved from sin's penalty. Romans 8:1, Paul said, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Justification. I'm saved from sin's power. Paul said, therefore no longer let sin have dominion, have reign, have control in your mortal bodies. And then finally, glorification. I am saved from sin's presence. Revelation chapter 22 verse 3, John said, I saw a new heaven and a new earth, and the old things had passed away, and everything was in heaven as it ought to be. I'm saved from sin's penalty. He's declared me not guilty. I'm saved from sin's power. He's every day given me victory that I could not have otherwise, and one day I'll be ultimately saved from the very presence of sin when I stand in glory with Jesus. Father, we thank You for the Word. We thank You for salvation. God, I pray that You would help us to walk closer to You. God, help us to do what we cannot do in our own strength and power, but what we can do if You'll help us. God, use this time of invitation. If there's anybody here under the sound of my voice who does not know You and the free pardon and forgiveness of sin, I pray that You would lead them to You this morning for salvation. God, use this time for Your glory and honor. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together and sing this morning one verse, Just As I Am.
Just as I am.